Hello, 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 hello. I got a new setup, I got a green screen, so I think now everything should be really better. So today we'll start with essay 315. This lecture will be purely in English so that South students can also be benefited by these. We are using our audit in 100 pages notes. Essay 315 talks about identifying and assessing the risk of material misstatement. Okay. How? Through understanding the entity and its environment. So you are trying to identify and assess the risk of material misstatement by understanding the entity. Look, if you make friends with someone, you will first try to understand that person, right? So if you are auditing someone, if you are auditing an entity, you first need to understand the entity and the environment in which it operates. So your RAP, that is your risk assessment procedures, are procedures to obtain an understanding of entity and its environment, including internal controls, to identify and assess risk of material misstatement at financial statement and assertion level. So this, we know that your risk of material misstatement is at two levels. One is your financial statement, other is your assertion level. This includes, so how are you going to determine, how are you going to understand the entity? You will inquire to management, you will perform analytical procedures, you will observe and you will inspect. So these are the ways how you will understand the entity. Now, understanding of entity and its environment. So auditor to obtain understanding of relevant industry, regulatory and other external factors, including your financial reporting framework. So auditor needs to understand what industry the entity is operating, what regulatory, legal, other frameworks are applicable to the entity. Nature of entity, including what operations it performs, the way the entity is structured and financed, what are the type of investments made by the entity, who has the ownership of the entity, what is the ownership and the governance structure. So there are four ways. One is your operations. Second is the way the entity is structured and financed. Third is your type of investments it makes, and fourth is the ownership and governance structure. Third point is selection and application of accounting policies. Selection and application of accounting policies is how does the entity select which accounting policies are applicable to it, and then how does it apply those accounting policies. And fourth is your internal controls relevant to audit. So these are four points to understand the entity. So first point is relevant industry understand, then you understand the nature of the entity as a whole. Next is what are the accounting policies, and fourth is your internal controls. Great. Okay, so four things are needed to understand the entity. Next is your identification and assessment of RMM. So identification and assessment we know is at two levels. So first is at your financial statement level. So risk of material misstatement that relate pervasively to financial statement as a whole. What do you mean by pervasively? Pervasively means as a whole. That is entirety, everything, everything. Okay, so relate pervasively to a financial statement as a whole and potentially affect many assertions. So anything that affects your whole financial statement will also of course affect assertions. Assertions are what? Your class of transactions, account balance and disclosures. Okay, so once you understand, once you are able to identify the risk of material misstatement, this will help you determine the nature, timing and extent of further audit procedures necessary. Only once you determine what is your risk of material misstatement will you know that how deep should I go, what should be my NTE of further audit procedures. Now, what are the assertions evaluated? Okay, so over here we have three assertions, right? One is your transaction, second is your account balance, and third is your disclosure level. So I have put all these three over here. Now what will you check within them? So your rule goes 5-4-4. Okay, so over here you will check five things in transaction, that is your occurrence, completeness, accuracy, cutoff and classification. What is it? Occurrence, completeness, accuracy, cutoff, classification. Occurrence is that the transaction has actually occurred, that you have recorded in your books, that has actually occurred. And any transaction that has occurred has to be recorded in your books, vice versa. Okay, only transactions that have occurred should be recorded. Your second is completeness. Your transaction should be complete. Your complete transaction should be recorded. Accuracy, your transaction should be recorded correctly. Cutoff. Cutoff means balance sheet dates. Okay, so your audit period starts suppose from say 1st April to 31st March. So only transactions that are between this period will be covered. That's why they have set cutoff that any transaction after 31st March will not be included because this is my cutoff date. Great. If I go any further, my hand will cut. Look. Yeah. So now this is my cutoff. Okay. So for audit, this is your cutoff date. Any transaction after this should not be recorded. Then next is your classification or transaction should be classified appropriately. What about account balances at the period end? All the balances that stand in your account. So existence, that is the amount the account balance should actually exist. Next is your rights and obligations. Any rights and obligations with regards to account balances. Third is your completeness. Your account balances should be completely reflected. And fourth is valuation and allocation. Okay. Then next point is presentation and disclosure. What has to be included in presentation and disclosure? What assertions have to be evaluated? First is with regards to occurrence and rights and obligation. That is the these have actually occurred and whether the company has rights and obligations against it. Second is completeness. Your transactions, your presentation and disclosure should be complete. Third is your classification and understandability. Look, the most important point about disclosure and your presentation is they should be classified perfectly and they should be understandable by any rational person who knows how to read financial statements. And last is your accuracy and valuation. That is, whatever amount you have disclosed or any valuation that you have disclosed, that should be accurate. Now, next talks about steps in RAP. That is your risk assessment procedure. What are the steps? So there are three steps. You're easy, very easy. First is what is the first? Where's my cursor? Yeah. First is you identify the risk. Second is you assess and evaluate identified risk. So you understand the risk. First is you only identify. Second is assess and evaluate. And third is relate identified risk to what could go wrong at the assertion level. So once you have understood the risk, now you have to determine that what can go wrong in the assertion level. Okay, your assertion level means your second point. What can go wrong over here? Now, risk requiring special consideration. There are certain risks where you might have to put more effort. You will have to put more consideration. So, any risk relating to fraud. Next is risk related to economic accounting development. Third is your complexity of transactions. Greater the complexity of transaction, more possibilities of risk. And fourth is your related party transaction because there is a scope for risk of material misstatement to be here in related party transactions. And coming to our last part is your risk in a CIS environment. Risk in a CIS environment means basically risk while auditing in an automated environment or in an IT environment. So your first part is risk imposed by IT or your CIS. What does CIS stand for? CIS stands for Computer Information System. So first is reliance on programs that process inaccurate data or inaccurate processing. So that is the programs that you are using, the applications that you are using, they are processing inaccurate data. So this is your risk. Now your second, third and fourth point all are regards to unauthorized. What does your second point talk about? Unauthorized access to data. That may result in destruction of data. If any person who should not have authorization to make changes in data or delete data, if he has access, he might delete data and you might lose all of it. Now your third part is unauthorized changes in master files. Master files is your ultimate top data, your base data that your company uses. Any changes in master files, suppose I maintain a fixed asset register. And in the master file, I've put that any time if I buy a furniture, its useful life will be 10 years. So now whenever I input in the system purchase furniture, automatically depreciation will be calculated according to 10 years. Why? Because in the master file, I've put it as 10 years. So any changes to master file, any unauthorized changes to master file, it will have a trickling effect and it will all the financial statements below it will have material misstatements. And your last part is unauthorized changes to systems. All the systems that we are using, if there is any unauthorized changes, that is a risk. There are four risks. One risk is regard that the system that we use that processes incorrect data, and three risks are regards to unauthorized access. Now, so what are the areas to be examined? Your areas to be examined is first is program development and maintenance. That is, what are the systems and the program that we are using? How is it maintained? How was it developed? so you will have to check that. Second is your physical CIS, that is your suppose your server room, anywhere your data is stored. So is there a fingerprint mechanism, is there a card mechanism, so that only authorized personnel can enter. Third point is system software support, that is all the systems that you are using, do you have any software support for it? So that you have to be, that has to be checked. And last part is processing of data. You have to understand how the data is processed by the system. So you will have to do a process walkthrough. This is called a process walkthrough, where you understand how each system or how each system uses data and what data process it performs. Next is components of internal control. Components of internal control, so these are five. So we have made a key, that is your CRICM. So now first is your control environment. This is your component of internal control, that is communication of ethical values. Then second is your RAP, that is your risk assessment procedure. It will help identify business risk, assess likelihood of occurrence. Third is your information system relevant to FR, that is your classes of transaction, accounting procedures and records. Fourth is your control activities relevant to audit, physical control, processing of information, segregation of duties, and last is your performance reviews. All of these activities which are relevant to the audit. What are the activities? First is physical control. Second is processing of information. Third is segregation of duties. And fourth is performance reviews. Okay. And last is your M, that is monitoring of controls. Assess effectiveness of internal control performance. So whether the internal controls that we have put in place, that we have put in place of the organization, are they effective? Effective in what? This will come further, that is prevent, detect and correct material misstatement. This is your main function of your internal control. So we should check, are they effective or not? Okay, and this is how we are done with this essay.